I gotta do more yoga. Oh, jeez.
Hello, everyone. Nate Vincent here with FCP Euro. Today on Race Cars Explained, we're going to be talking about a fuel cell and the fuel system in a race car. Everything from putting fuel in to what differentiates this fuel tank from what's found in a normal street-going car. Let's get started. So right here in front of me, we have the fuel cell from this Golf TCR behind me. The thing you're going to notice is it already has the cover taking off, and you can see that this is a big rubber bladder. This bladder is built out of high-strength rubber, and the reason for it is to keep it from rupturing in the case of an accident. So this bladder can expand to about 5 times its original size before it actually ruptures and spills fuel. The reason for that is if the car is ever in an accident, the last thing we want is fuel going everywhere inside the car. This increases the safety of the car and cuts down on the likelihood of the car catching on fire after an accident. That said, rubber has a lifespan. It doesn't last forever. So this fuel cell actually expires after June 2022. So these fuel cells are given about a 4 to 5 year lifespan of legal use. If the car is to be used after that, this fuel cell has to be replaced. The biggest difference between race cars and street cars is we can't rely on gravity to feed our fuel pumps. Typically on a street car, you can go to the lowest portion of the tank and that's where the fuel will accumulate and feed the pump. But in a race car, because we see high G-force in turning and braking, that fuel is constantly sloshing from one side of the tank to the other. So there's a couple things that are done to this fuel cell to mitigate that. The first thing is it is filled with a foam, basically like a big sponge. And that doesn't actually hold the fuel to one side or the other, but it keeps it from sloshing back and forth. If you imagine, if I had a sponge and I turned it up on the side, the water would still run down and eventually drip out of it. But what it would do is it would do it slowly. So really the foam inside a fuel cell is to dampen the forces of the weight of the fuel moving from one side to the other. This makes the car handle better and easier to drive. The other thing you're going to notice is this fuel cell has 4 pickup points in it. One in this corner, one in this corner, one in this corner here, and one in this corner. So basically all 4 corners have what we call a jet pump or a pickup point. So even if these two have no fuel on them and all the fuel is rushed over to the left side of the fuel cell, these 2 jet pumps will pick up fuel. Or if the car is braking and all the fuel rushes to the front, these 2 pumps will pick up fuel. So there's always 2 pumps in the system that are picking up fuel. These pumps are called jet pumps because they're not actually powered by an electrical pump. Now these jet pumps are actually run off a Venturi effect from the main pump. So the Venturi effect is based on pressures. So if you have a steady state flow through a nozzle, and this would be the nozzle where it would restrict down, and this is the steady state flow front and back. What happens is through that nozzle, while the fluid increases in velocity, moves faster, the pressure decreases. Those are inverse of each other. When that pressure decreases, it actually creates a vacuum. The reason it creates vacuum is because between this high pressure area, this low pressure area, and the high pressure area on the other side, this is always searching for equilibrium. Just like a hurricane works, you actually have a really low pressure system in the middle of a hurricane, and all the air from the outside is trying to rush into the middle, and that's what creates a cyclone. So what the engineers at Volkswagen have done is they've used this system to basically feed the jet pumps. So if you have your main fuel pump feeding this system right here, so your main flow is coming from your main fuel pump, and then you have 4 jet pumps that are tapped into this, they feed into this nozzle or the Venturi right here. As the flow is moving through here and this creates a low pressure, it's going to create a vacuum here, therefore a suction, and it's going to suck fuel from those 4 corners and feed this main system. The beauty of this is you don't actually have to have a fuel pump in those 4 corners because they would constantly be starving from fuel and that fuel pump would burn out in a very short time. So if you see right here, you can see this is the main fuel pump and it is actually feeding fuel up through this hose. But using a Venturi principle, you can see that this T right here is actually creating suction because of the fuel flow through here. So all of the pumps on the corners are driven by the fuel that is flowing out of the main pump in the tank. Now, the last thing is all of these 4 pumps are feeding what we call a swirl pot. So there's a swirl pot, which is a big tub right in the middle of this fuel cell where this main fuel pump actually lives right inside. Now, all of these jet pumps are actually swirling the fuel around, so they all come in at an angle. And the fuel is swirling around this fuel cell and constantly filling itself up, so this pump constantly has fuel to suck. The reason for that swirl is that swirling effect, the centrifugal force of it, actually overcomes the G-forces associated with braking and cornering. So it constantly has a fuel supply in that bowl at all times. So the last thing we're going to talk about is race fuel. So in these cars, we actually run 100 octane race fuel. Most people think the higher the octane, the more flammable the fuel, but it's actually the opposite. The higher the octane, the more the fuel is able to resist combustion. So that means you can run the engine hotter and you can tune it more aggressively to get more performance out of it without having the engine pre-ignite. Pre-ignition is when the fuel in the combustion chamber actually ignites before the spark plug tells it to, and this can have major damaging effects on the engine's internals. While we run 100 octane in the series we run, most fuel is dependent on the series. So all the cars racing against each other are running the exact same fuel to level the playing field. So if this was a normal street GTI, you'd put fuel right here. You can see, open it up, but we actually have the air jack system right here. So on this race car, we actually have a separate fuel fill right here. Now, if this was an endurance race car, as this is not, this is a sprint car, you would see a bigger fuel fill here. The reason for that is on an endurance car where you're doing pit stops, where you're adding fuel to the car, you need to have two lines in. One is a fuel line in, the other is a vent line for the air in the fuel tank to escape so you can fill as quickly as possible. Today in racing, all fuel fills have to be done via gravity, which means the fuel is fed from a tank that sits up about 3 or 4 feet higher than the car, fed down into the car. Back in the day, back in the 70s and the 80s in Formula One, they were trying to fill cars as fast as they possibly could. Some of the techniques were actually to take beer kegs, fill them with fuel, and pressurize them with super high pressure. They could actually fill about 25 gallons of fuel in a car in about 3 seconds. But if the check valves didn't function properly or a line burst, it could become very dangerous on pit road with hot brakes and hot engines, basically spreading atomized fuel throughout the entire pit lane. So it was banned from racing in general. So one of the most important things about racing is keeping our weight as low as possible. To do this, we actually pump the fuel tank completely dry after every session on track. Then, if we know we have a 40-minute session or a 50-minute session on track, we calculate the exact amount of fuel we need for that session. We will weigh that fuel to make sure we have the right volume, and then we add it to the tank. Now for the pump out procedure, it's right down here. So you can see, we actually have a little gauge right here that shows how much fuel is in the car. This is reset every time the car is pumped out. So we don't actually have a fuel level indicator in the tank like most street cars do. To pump the fuel out of this car, we actually have a battery pickup right here that we plug this controller into, and then this connector actually plugs directly into the fuel pump. We can just basically turn this on and this pumps the fuel out. That will make the fuel pump circulate fuel through the system. Now to get that fuel out of the system, we come up to the front. And at the front of the car, typically if the engine's in it, right on the side of the timing cover lives this. This is your fuel line coming in, this is a pressure transducer, and this is your fuel line going to the high pressure fuel pump on the engine. We unplug this little fitting right here, and we have a specially made hose that we plug into this, right, that, and then we can pump the fuel out into a container right in front of the car. In a race car, weight is one of the most critical things, as we already talked about. But one of the other parts that's really critical about the weight is lowering the center of gravity, or lowering that weight as close to the ground as possible and balancing it right to left inside the car. So as you can see, where I'm sitting right now is where the fuel cell lives normally in this Volkswagen GTI TCR. This is actually the standard location where the fuel tank would live under the back seats in the car on a street car. One of the benefits of this location is it keeps the fuel close to the ground, which lowers the center of gravity. It's also relatively in the middle of the car front to back, which means depending on the fuel load, whether it's a heavy fuel load or a light fuel load, the weight on the rear axle and the weight on the front axle doesn't differentiate all that much. That means the car is well balanced whether it's on a low fuel load or a high fuel load. Now looking around me, you can see some of the other components and elements of this fuel system. This is the feed line that feeds fuel into the tank. You can also see right here, this is the fuel feed to the high pressure fuel pump. This is what takes the fuel from the cell and provides it to the engine. And then right here, you can see we have a nice little motorsport connector that this plugs into the fuel pump itself. This is what is unplugged when we pump the fuel tank out. So I really hope you enjoyed this episode of Race Cars Explained. If you liked what you saw, please hit the thumbs up button. And if you want to see more of this, please subscribe. Catch you in the next one.
Yeah, you look at the camera! Yeah!